Please remain standing and turn to page one as we follow the printed order of service in our bulletin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy, seeking and imploring your grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. Merciful God and Heavenly Father, whose grace endures to all generations, you are patient and long-suffering, and will forgive the sins and transgressions of those who truly repent. Look with compassion upon your people and hear their supplications. We have sinned against you and are unworthy of your goodness and love. Remember not our transgressions. Have mercy upon us and help us, O God. Grant us remission of all our sins. Give us the grace of your Spirit, that we may amend our ways, and with you obtain everlasting life, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God, and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Stir up your power, O Lord, and come, and help us by your might, that the sins which weigh us down may be quickly lifted by your grace and mercy. You live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The first reading for this fourth Sunday in Advent is from 2 Samuel, the 7th chapter. After the king was settled in his palace and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, he said to Nathan the prophet, "Here I am, living in a palace of cedar while the ark of God remains in a tent." Nathan replied to the king, "Whatever you have in mind, go ahead and do it, for the Lord is with you." That night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, saying, "Go and tell my servant David, this is what the Lord says. Are you the one to build me a house to dwell in? I have not dwelt in a house from the day I brought the Israelites up out of Egypt to this day. I have been moving from place to place with a tent as my dwelling. Wherever I have moved with all the Israelites, I have been moving from place to place with tents. Wherever I have moved with all of the Israelites, did I ever say to any of your rulers whom I have commanded to shepherd my people Israel, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now then, tell my servant David, this is what the Lord Almighty says. I took you from the pasture, from following the flocks, to be ruler of my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone. I have cut off all your enemies from before you. Now I'll make your name great like the names of the greatest men of the earth. And I will provide a place for my people Israel and will plant them so that they can have a home of their own and no longer be disturbed. Wicked people will not oppress them anymore as they did at the beginning and have done ever since the time I appointed leaders over my people Israel. I will also give you rest from all your enemies. Your house and your kingdom will endure forever before me. Your throne will be established forever." This is the word of the Lord. Our lesson from Paul's letter to the church at Rome, Romans, the 16th chapter. "Now to him who is able to establish you by my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery hidden for long ages past, now revealed and made known for the prophetic writings by the command of the eternal God, so that all nations might believe and obey him. To the only wise God be glory forever through Jesus Christ. Amen." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand once again for the reading of the Holy Gospel. Gospel according to St. Luke, the first chapter. Glory be to thee, O Lord. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary is greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she who was said to be barren is in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." Then the angel left her. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to thee, O Christ. We now join together in confessing our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. "I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. We'd like the children, however, to come up and sit on chancel steps. They're not performing. We're going to just have a brief children's message. They get their chance to shine later this afternoon. This looks like girls' night out. That's okay, I like girls. My mom was a girl, my sister, my daughter, my wife. The girls are cool, they're awesome. Anyway, how many of you have seen the movie The Grinch That Stole Christmas? Yeah, you realize that's make-believe, right? Yeah, and the reason I mentioned that, I read the news that little boy dad in Alabama was so scared the Grinch was gonna steal Christmas for real. He called the police. Yeah. Little five-year-old boy called the police and he was worried that the Grinch was going to steal Christmas. And his dad heard him on the phone. What are you doing? I was afraid. So the policeman was very nice and he came to his house and then he invited him to look at his squad car, but the policeman was very nice because he liked The Grinch too. That was his favorite movie. He said, in fact, he watched it every year with his children. So now I was going to ask you, do you guys remember the song, You're a Mean One, Mr. Grinch? Can you sing it? You know all the words? Okay, let's see if I get, by the way, Pastor doesn't normally bring his cell phone to church, but let's see if we get that song. we'll play that later. You know, is that amazing? Of course, you know the Grinch. Let me see if I can find the best words. Stink, stank, stank. You're a rotomous Grinch. You're the king of sinful sods. Your heart's a dead tomato, squashed with moldy purple spots. Mr. Grinch, your soul is an appalling dump of gold-plated, the most disgraceful assortment of deplorable rubbish imaginable. Not in terms of endearment. The reason why I'm sharing this is because we know that the Grinch is make-believe, and it's fun. But sin is not make-believe. And when I read that and I listened to that song the other day, your soul is an appalling dump heap overflowing with the most disgraceful assortment of deplorable rubbish imaginable. I got to thinking that's exactly how God looks at our hearts. That's why we need a Savior. Because if we saw our hearts the way God did, we'd be deplorable. We'd almost rather be with that crocodile. But yeah, I think of that great description. You're a crooked, jerky jockey, and you drive a crooked horse, Mr. Grinch. A three-decker sauerkraut and toadstool sandwich with arsenic sauce. Wow, that's a pretty rotten character. But the reality is we're born in sin. We have sin. It doesn't take too long for that to show its ugly head in our lives. But the good news, we have a Savior who forgives us our sin and will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So, did you notice something was going on outside finally? Did you notice it started snowing? We're going to have a white Christmas. But because Jesus came, because he lived and he died on the cross, we can have a whiter than snow Christmas because he forgives us and makes us white as snow. Let's pray. Father, though our hearts are unclean and full of deplorable things, we thank you that in Jesus we are made clean. In him we are made whiter than snow. For that we're eternally grateful. So this can be a joyous, a peace-filled Christmas. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay. You guys may be seated. Thank you. Good job for singing that. Well, she did a great job. She had no idea she was going to be singing a solo today in church, had no idea we were going to do that, but she persevered, and that's really, really great. Let's sing together our sermon hymn. sure my phone does not go off during the service, get an airplane mode or something. Speaking of airplanes, I was delighted yesterday to pick up our daughter, or last night, pick up the airport in Chicago, but got home about 3 o'clock this morning. Got to bed at 3:30. So if I look like I'm having an out-of-body experience, it's not because of eggnog or anything like that. It's just fatigue. You know what the prayer of a pastor is when he's suffering sleep deprivation? Lord, have mercy. Not only on you as well, but let's pray. Gracious God and Father, we thank you that your mercies are new each day. Lord, that is true this day. Thank you that for your unfailing love and kindness. Thank you this morning as we read your word, your promise to David to establish his throne forever and ever. And we know that it's fulfilled by the Lord Jesus Christ, David's greater son. And we pray, oh God, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts would be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and redeemer. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Hope, love, joy, and peace. So today we come to our fourth and final Sunday in Advent, and we unwrap the gift of peace. We've done hope and love and joy the last couple weeks, and today it's peace. You know, we hear a lot about peace, especially this time of year, peace on earth. And that's what people so desperately want. But as we look at the world around us, it often seems to be anything but peace in our world. Now, if by peace one means the absence of conflict, that's just simply a grand delusion. There's been very few times in human history where there's not been conflict. In fact, I wish I could remember recently reading how many years they've done a study, how many years we've not had conflict in the last 500 years. I think it was a total of 46 years. So if by peace we mean absence of conflict, we're in serious trouble. Some of you that remember, I grew up in the Vietnam era. We could have been old enough, was old enough to serve, but mercifully did not have to do that. But I remember every year at this time of year, they would have a ceasefire to honor Christmas. And every year they never disappointed. The ceasefire was always broken. You could count on it. Simply because you cannot, by human words or wishful thinking, declare peace. But the peace of which we speak this morning is far more than the absence of conflict. It is a deep and abiding peace that only Christ can give. It's an internal peace that he gives to us. We don't generate it. We don't wish for it. We don't will it for ourselves. It is a gift of God's grace. It's a gift of peace that Jesus said that I give you, the world cannot give you, and the world cannot take it away. It's a peace that does not come from a pill. It doesn't come in the bottom of a bottle. It's simply a gift of God's grace. When we talk about peace this morning, the gift of peace, it's a spiritual peace. It's an inner peace, a peace that is bestowed, not one we achieve by our own efforts. This morning I want to talk about peace in a twofold sense. First of all, there's peace with God, and then there is the peace of God. To be at peace with God comes the moment we are received into divine favor through faith in Christ. To be at peace with God means we are justified freely by his grace or in a right relationship with him. We no longer must strive to please him or placate him or earn his favor. The amazing thing, the moment we are justified freely by his grace, the struggling, the striving ends and we are at peace because I don't have to prove myself to God. He accepts me unconditionally because of the merits of Jesus Christ. See what? The most amazing peace comes when I know that my sins are forgiven in Christ. Absolutely amazing peace that you can't find anywhere else, because one of the things that will rob us of joy and peace is a guilty, accusing, condemning conscience. And if you would apply those attributes of the Grinch's heart to your heart, you see how desperately we are in need of forgiveness and why those things would rob us of peace. So we need to, first of all, in a vertical sense, we need to have the peace, be at peace with God, to be reconciled to God, to be justified freely by his grace in Christ. That's an awesome thing. In fact, Paul said, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God. Then there's not only the peace with God, there's the peace of God that passes all human understanding. It's a peace of God that we can experience in every situation in life. It is, as somebody said once upon a time, it's peace amidst the pieces. Life can be falling down all around us. It can be turmoil, unrest, even within our hearts. Yet God in Christ can give us a peace that passes all understanding. And it's a kind of peace we also desperately need. All too often seems so elusive, but it doesn't have to be elusive. It doesn't have to be that way. The peace of God is ours in Christ this morning. It's ours through Him. Remember, it's not just the absence of conflict. Actually, the peace that comes as a gift from God is a peace that is about how the storm is raging around us. We can have the peace of God. In fact, if I look within for myself or for peace, I'm not going to find it, because the prophet describes my heart before God as tossing like a restless sea, like the tossing of the sea. We need peace that comes from somewhere else other than from within. And it's a supernatural peace that comes from above. How do we find peace in the midst of the chaos and confusion, the conflicts of life? We do it by keeping our hearts and minds focused on God. Simply by trusting Him. A number of years ago, I heard this verse one time. There's certain verses I think of Scripture so profound. They make such an impression on me that the moment I hear them, I've retained them. I don't know. It's a blessing from God. But this is a verse I heard one time back in 1972. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusts in thee. Isaiah 26:3. You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. Why? Because he trusts you. The key to having peace within is trusting Him. Keeping our hearts and minds focused on the living God who gives us His peace that passes all understanding. This is what Paul said in Philippians. I think we read this just recently, but I want to read it again. Philippians chapter 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I will say it, rejoice. And I think that's one of the keys to peace, is rejoicing in the Lord. Paul said, let your reasonableness be made known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Don't be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And this is the result, Paul says, will happen. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Now, when he says the peace of God will guard your heart, what Paul is doing in the book of Philippians has a lot of military imagery, which you really have to mind that to get that, understand that. But the picture that Paul is trying to convey in that one verse is a guard standing at the door to keep trouble out. So you think of a sentinel on guard at a door, at a gate, keeping trouble out. God is telling us in St. Paul's inspired words that when you trust in Him, He will give you a peace. It will stand on guard to the door of your heart to keep all trouble out. Awesome imagery there. You know what I think is one of the greatest illustrations of true peace? And a real tranquility. Think of a little newborn. We've had a few of those in recent years in our family. Think of a newborn child safely cradled in its mother's arms, nursing its mother's breast. Think of that image of that little child, not a care in the world. That doesn't mean the world isn't in turmoil. The child is totally oblivious to what's going on around, safe and secure in its mother's arms, not a care in the world, sound asleep, and the world seems to be in chaos. What an awesome picture of peace. God wants us to be at peace. It's His desire for us. But you know what? I think in the New Testament, the greatest example of peace, and I pray that day by day that God would bestow this peace upon us, the picture of Jesus with His disciples in the boat. Here they are. They had been ministering, feeding people, healing the sick, and all that, and they're tired. They get in the boat, and they're going across the sea. And all of a sudden, the wind kicks up unexpectedly. Well, it should have been expected because that happens all the time in the Sea of Galilee. But they're out there, and the waves are billowing into the boat. The wind is blowing, and they're scared. But where is Jesus in the midst of the storm? Fast asleep on a cushion in the stern of the boat. Now, if that isn't the greatest example of peace, the poor disciples didn't get it yet because they woke him up. Lord, don't you care that we're perishing? He wasn't going to let them perish. He's not going to let you perish either. But you got to believe it. Trust him at his word. Oh, Lord, look around. They were looking at the circumstance, and their hearts are just filled with fear. Jesus gets up and speaks the word and says, peace, be still. And that sea was calm, smooth as a sheet of glass. I don't know what storms you're going through in your own life. Forget the storms that are out there in the world around us. I don't know what storms you're going through, but your heart might just look this morning like that toss into the sea. But Jesus can tell your heart that's troubled, peace be still. I understand there's a lot of stuff that is disturbing, and I can't say that there aren't things in our lives from our own sins, the circumstances around us, the illness and conflict of the world that causes our hearts to be at peace. But peace doesn't come. It's not an emotion. It's not a temporary thing. It's not an instant thing. It comes from a deep and abiding relationship and walk with Jesus Christ, that I know in Jesus Christ that every situation will work for his good, for my good and for his glory. There's nothing I can't face. I can be like Jesus in that boat fast asleep. If Jesus is Lord of your life, he's in your boat, if you will. You have nothing to fear. He's not going to let you go down to defeat. He's not going to let you perish eternally. That's why he was born. That's why he came. That's why he lived and died on the cross, so you and I can be reconciled to God. And that's the ultimate peace, that no matter what happens in life, I can have peace. I think one of my favorite hymns, and I know I've shared this before, that you look around, you read the headlines, and it doesn't seem like there's peace anymore. Listen to these words of I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, written, I believe, during the Civil War. Yeah, a lot of strife back then, right? I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play. Wild and sweet, the words repeat of peace on earth, goodwill toward men. I thought how, as the day had come, the belfries of all Christendom had rolled along the unbroken song with peace on earth, goodwill to men. Get this, but in despair I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said. For hate is strong and it mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. One can see how he felt that way. But then his final stanza, then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor does he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail. With peace on earth, goodwill toward men. May God grant you his peace now and in the year to come. Amen. And now may that peace, that's beyond human comprehension, truly keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus and the life everlasting. Amen. We're going to call in the ushers at this time to receive our tithes and offerings. Let us pray. God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of hope, of love, of joy, and peace. And these are ours because the greatest gift of all, that indescribable gift, the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we often remember as we read Scripture that when he was born, is wrapped in swaddling cloths. And yet, Father, the great mystery of Christmas is not that he was wrapped in cloth, but that God was wrapped in human flesh. Father, this Christmas we celebrate the mystery of the incarnation, that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that Christ came to reveal you, to remind us of your love, that he became what we are, that we might become what he is. He became sin, who knew no sin, that in him we might become the righteousness of God. We thank you for his gifts that keep on giving, the gift of hope of everlasting life. We long for the day when he will come again as a reigning king, come in the glory of his Father with the myriads of holy angels to receive us to himself, that we might reign with him forever and ever. On that day, all sin will be gone, and we'll be clothed in robes of righteousness and be perfect and complete in your sight, lacking nothing. But until that day, we stand complete in your presence. Help us to be steadfast and immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in Jesus our labor is never in vain. Father, when we think of our Lord Jesus Christ reconciling us to the Father, God and sinners reconciled, help us live lives of gratitude. Help us live lives that are worthy of our calling in Christ. Help us not to be conformed to the world, but to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Father, may this Christmas be a time for resolve to grow in faith and grow in grace and holiness in our Lord Jesus Christ. Keep our eyes focused on him, not in circumstances, not in self, but on Christ. Father, we do thank you for your gifts of healing, because know that in Christ we can experience healing. We pray for those that are ill, that your hand of grace would be upon them. For those recovering from cancer treatment, those receiving physical therapy, we pray, Lord, your hand would be upon them. Father, for those who have loved ones that are battling illness, we name them quietly before you in our hearts, even the unspoken prayers you hear and answer for Jesus' sake. Father, we pray for those who are troubled this Christmas time. Grant them your peace in Christ, our Savior. For some, the Christmas season accentuates the loneliness. Befriend them. Direct their hearts to the fellowship of your church. Father, for those who are struggling financially, we pray that you provide for the needs according to your riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Father, for those that are making decisions coming up now and at the end of this year and beginning next, you would guide them by your word and spirit. You said in your word, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not rely on your own insight. All your ways, acknowledge him and he'll direct your path. Lord, we know that you govern in the affairs of men. You govern in our lives. Be Lord of our lives in 2018. Lord, you have told us through your word that we make our plans, but you direct our path. Lord, we give you veto power to override our decisions because you know what is best for your children. Father, we thank you that you do hear and answer prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us all to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen. Amen.